said, if God notices a sparrow falling to the ground, certainly God will notice you. Greetings, and welcome to this Wadawi First United Methodist Worship Where You Are experience here on May 10, 2020. I'm Gary Whetstone, a retired United Methodist pastor, affiliating with this congregation under the leadership of the Reverend Josh Hickman. The worship team and I hope that you will linger through this service to its end, because in particular, there are four things that we hope will be meaningful to you. A little surprise. Secondly, Pastor Josh has us in a sermon series, and I'd like to give you a review of those building blocks of faith. And there's a line in a Christian hymn that will be offered that mentions that there is no guilt, there is no fear. This is the power of Christ that we would like for you to focus on. And then, of course, I have some reflections on a passage of Scripture that I would like to share with you. The passage of Scripture comes from John's Gospel, the 14th chapter. The opening verse, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." Jesus tells the disciples that he is leaving, but that he will return. And then he says, "You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going. So how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
And let us pray. We need thee. Oh God, every hour we need thee. So bless us now as we come to you. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Name one thing about mothers that you are thankful for.
My mother is kind to me.
Now, what would you like to say to all the mothers out there?
Happy Mother's Day.
Wait. Yeah. Would you name something you're thankful for mothers for? Would you like to say something else about Happy Mother's Day?
I like trees. So, mothers, we hope you have a great, great day today, and we love you and we're thankful for you. Happy Mother's Day. On April 19, Pastor Josh launched into a sermon series entitled The Building Blocks of Faith. And starting then on April 19, using Thomas, the disciple, Pastor Josh encouraged us to have honest faith. And the insight that he offered that I found to be most helpful was to say that it's a both and. That oftentimes we think it's either or. You either have faith with no doubts, or you have doubt and therefore no faith. And he said, it's a both and, that you do have faith even if you experience some doubts. Alfred Lord Tennyson once wrote, there is more faith in honest doubt, believe me, than in half the creeds. I believe that to be the message that Pastor Josh gave to us on April 19. On April 26, Josh invited us to join two disciples traveling from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And during the journey, the scriptures were opened up to them. And then, in the breaking of the bread, they saw the risen Christ and immediately left Emmaus and returned to Jerusalem to tell the disciples. Pastor Josh told us to stay alert to the presence of the living Christ and then to tell our story. Betty Berry, a member of a church that I once pastored, told me one time that when she woke up in the morning, she'd swing around and put her feet on the ground. But before supporting any weight, she would say, Lord, what are we going to get into today? That's alert responsiveness, being open to where the Spirit is moving, and then telling your story. Last Sunday, we were in the room with the disciples, enjoying a meal, benefiting from the teaching of the apostles. And Josh encouraged us to remember the importance of community. And he said, we're not experiencing social distancing today. We're experiencing physical distancing, where we may not be able to be closer than 6 feet. We may not be able to gather in a sanctuary. But because of technology, we're still able to foster community. And how important it is to use community to learn, to grow, to share, to serve, to hold one another accountable. These are the building blocks of faith. Honest faith, alert responsiveness, and the fostering and building of community. In a moment, I'll add a fourth building block to faith. But I certainly hope that you have found these messages helpful in your Christian walk along the way.
Solid ground. First.
"I admit," she said, "it's easier said than done." That admission is true for a number of things. Dieting, easier said than done. Controlling your anger, easier said than done. Being patient, that's mine, easier said than done. And certainly the sentence would apply to the words of Jesus here in John 14. "Let not your hearts be troubled." It's easier said than done, because you and I are wired to be anxious. That's how we're wired. Anxiety is that dis-ease, that uneasiness in the face of danger and in the face of an uncertain future. It's different than worry. More often than not, worry has to do with imagined danger or amplified danger. So if the astronomers tell us that an asteroid of a mile-wide version is having a flyby, a near flyby, but then they mention that near is 2 million miles away, well, for them, that's near, and it's near enough. But the person who can't sleep at night now because they're afraid that the asteroid will strike, that's amplified, and that's worry. Anxiety is different. Anxiety is our response to the presence of danger and in the face of an uncertain future. And you and I are wired to be anxious. One day there was this zoologist and a friend taking a morning walk. They had to speak up to hear one another because the sidewalk was within 60 feet of a busy four-lane highway. As they crested this hill, suddenly the zoologist stopped and said to his friend, "I'd like to show you something." They backed down the hill slightly and started moving around it through a wood grove. And as they made their way through the trees, the zoologist picked up some branches, some twigs. As they came around the other side of the hill and then worked their way to the top, the zoologist pointed. And down between the sidewalk and the four-lane highway was a rabbit grazing. Nibble, 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 jump. Nibble, 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 jump. Jump, jump, nibble, nibble, nibble. And then the zoologist took a twig and snapped it. And immediately, the rabbit sat up. Ears were up, turning to the right and to the left. And the zoologist said to his friend, "The rabbit had learned that the noise from the highway posed no danger, but the rabbit remained always alert to danger's presence." That's being wired to be anxious. You are so wired. I'm wired. And so were the disciples. In the upper room, Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." And you and I may be very, very familiar with those words. And what we need to do is to kind of shrug off that ho-hum with these words, because Jesus says these words in response to a high degree of anxiety within the disciples. They were scared. They were anxious. They were afraid, because Jesus did some things there in the upper room. He acted in some ways. And he said some things that was most unsettling. As they were cloistered there in that upper room, Jesus first stood up He took off his academic robe, his teacher's robe, and put on a servant's girdle and started to wash the disciples' feet. Snap, what's going on? We also see Jesus just a little later, after he explained why he did what he did, being very troubled in his spirit. Snap, why is Jesus so troubled? And then Jesus said some things that were most unsettling. He announced to them, one of you is not clean. One of you will betray me. Snap, betray who? And then Jesus said, in a little while, you will see me no longer. And where I am going, you are not able to go. Snap. Here in the upper room, as Jesus was drawing his earthly ministry to a close, as he was facing the cross, as he was becoming aware of his sacrifice and how the disciples would respond, he did some things, he acted some ways, and he said some things most unsettling to the disciples, and they were afraid. And Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. And what I would like for you to notice is what Thomas and Philip do. Because I believe how they responded to the words of Jesus is a building block of faith for you and me, as well as for them. When Jesus said that you know the way, it was Thomas that admitted, no, we don't. Show us the way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father apart from me. I am the way. And then Jesus said, you know the Father. And it was Philip that says, no, we don't. Show us the Father. And that will be enough for us. These are teaching moments for Jesus, stylistic to the Gospel of John. But I would suggest that what is happening here is that Thomas and Philip are exercising what I would call abiding questions. Now for me, an abiding question is not one that just lingers and lasts for a long time. An abiding question is not a nagging question. An abiding question is not one that can't be answered. In John's Gospel, a major theme that we find throughout the chapters has to do with abiding in Jesus and inviting Jesus to abide with us. Almost all of John 15 is devoted to that particular theme, but it begins here. For in this high degree of anxiety, in sensing the danger, in sensing an uncertain future, what do we find Thomas and Philip doing? But turning towards Jesus, asking questions of Jesus, seeking to know more from Jesus. They want answers, they want clarity, they want to abide in him and have Jesus abide in them. This is a building block of faith because oftentimes you and I encounter these moments of anxiety, of uncertain futures. And we wonder what's going to happen, what's going to happen to us. And it's scary. And Jesus is saying, when afraid, turn to me. Abiding questions happens to be what many of the psalmists exercise. If you're familiar with 150 psalms, almost one-third of them have these abiding questions embedded in them. How long, O Lord, a psalmist cries out. Why do you stand afar off, another psalmist asks. My God, why have you forsaken me? Is an abiding question because the fear, the anxiety, that these psalmists felt, they turned Godward. No wonder the Jewish community took these poems and set them to music and add them to their worship hymnal. Because when afraid, the response most helpful is to lean in, to approach God, to offer them to God, and to ask God to be a part of your life. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, learned this lesson firsthand. He was on a ship sailing from Georgia to England when a storm came up that threatened the very life of that ship. And John Wesley was absolutely terrified. But on the ship with them was a small group of German Christians called Moravians. And they stood there on the deck holding hands and singing Christian hymns. Children, women, men alike, holding hands and singing, abiding in Christ and asking Christ to abide with them. John Wesley was so taken by their calm that later he inquired, what was their secret? And they, of course, said, we have Christ. Why should we be afraid? Jesus said to the disciples, and Jesus says to us, let not your hearts be troubled. It's easier said than done, that's for sure. But Thomas and Philip demonstrate, the psalmists demonstrate, the Moravian Christians demonstrate, that when you're anxious and you seek to have that heart untroubled, take your questions to Jesus and abide in him. Carl Wilson Baker, the poet, penned these words. Courage is armor the blind man wears, the calloused scar of outlived despairs. Courage is fear that has sinned its prayer. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid, Jesus said. Easier said than done, but it's possible as you abide in Christ and Christ abides in you. May it be so for you this day. Let us pray. So we pray that your Spirit might abide with us during this new week. May it help us to face whatever challenges that are out there with a measure of grace and strength and courage. For we ask it in the name of the very one who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The mission of the Wadawi First United Methodist Church is deeply influenced by the mission of the United Methodist Church, which is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And so I must offer you the opportunity that if you do not know Jesus, perhaps today is that time for you to turn to him and offer to him an abiding question, like, Lord Jesus, I need help. Will you add my name to your list? Jesus, as you prepare a place, will you come for me as well as others? Will you allow me to be your disciple? Jesus will not turn such a question away, but will respond. And he will give you the power to become a child of God. And then your journey with Christ begins. And then you can join with us as we seek to love God, to serve others, and to grow disciples of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you.